This is my topic, and the contents of my talk is listed here. First of all, I would like to tell you about general anesthesia, how we see it, and what is understood by general anesthesia. And when I now talk about anesthesia, I mean general anesthesia, where we are really affecting consciousness, not about regional or local anesthesia. Then I'm going to talk briefly about possibilities to measure what we call depth of anesthesia in a clinical setting, very briefly. Then I will show some imaging data from my own studies and also some other studies. And if we have time, a few words about our future plans for new studies. And I have a very pragmatic approach to this question. I'm a clinical anesthesiologist, but doing also research, and I have listed my motivations to do this kind of research. And I think that understanding the neurobiology of human consciousness would benefit the development of diagnosis and treatment of borderline states of consciousness. That's one reason this is important. And also understanding how these drugs work, it could help us to develop new and better ways to exercise our practice and even develop new anesthetic drugs by finding the targets to induce unconsciousness and general anesthesia. And then the third very important point is that these results maybe could also be utilized in the development of better methods to measure this, what we call depth of anesthesia. Unintended intraoperative awareness is still a big problem. Every day in the United States, about 60,000 people undergo general anesthesia, and the risk of being aware during the procedure is about 1 in 1,000. That means 60 cases every day in this country. So the problem is not solved. And then, of course, doing this kind of research, I have become more and more interested in these philosophical aspects of consciousness. And I start by showing the great picture by Stephen, also shown yesterday, about looking at consciousness in 2D. We have the level of consciousness, and we have the which is really about arousability, and then we have the contents of consciousness, what we can call awareness. And there is a straight line normally between these two. And I would like to point out what is general anesthesia. It's really something between normal physiological sleep and then coma. And in this presentation, I try to explain what general anesthesia is, what is common with coma or pathological brain states, and how it relates to normal physiological sleep. First of all, there are three main things in general anesthesia, and that's of course the unconsciousness. Then we need to make the conditions perfect for the surgeon, and we normally use muscle relaxants to induce akinesia. And then, of course, one important aspect is preventing nociception by giving analgesics. Typically, we give strong opiates to alleviate the pain. And general anesthesia is a combination of these three, and typically we are using different drugs. We are giving the anesthetics or hypnotics, we are giving the muscle relaxants, and then we are giving the strong opioids or analgesics. And in addition to these three main platforms, one very important aspect of general anesthesia is, of course, amnesia. Of course, if you induce unconsciousness, you probably have amnesia also. And then one important aspect of general anesthesia is attenuation of stress responses. So this is partly related to the analgesic drug administration, of course. How we define that nowadays, general anesthesia, we can use these kind of terms, combined anesthesia, emphasizing that we are giving these different drugs, but also a very good term already introduced in the 1920s is so-called balanced anesthesia, emphasizing that we take care of the homeostasis of our patients and gives combination of different drugs. Of course, in this presentation today, I'm going to concentrate on the unconsciousness aspect of anesthesia. I already mentioned kind of this problem. This is a very illustrative picture by a Swedish artist, Lasse Persson, about unintended awareness. And especially when we give these muscle relaxant agents, we may end up of having a phenotypically sleeping and unconscious patient, but in reality, the patient is aware and can even feel pain. And this can be a very traumatizing experience and can have serious consequences for the subject. And as I mentioned, this happens 60 times every day in this country. The next slide is a kind of illustration of what happens during normal general anesthesia. Now we are using different drugs. We are giving the hypnotics and probably muscle relaxants and the analgesics. I don't go into details, but you see what happens in what we call induction of anesthesia. That is the start of general anesthesia. But I would like you to especially look at the maintenance of the anesthesia, which we can call surgical anesthesia. And what is typical for this surgical anesthesia is really deep unconsciousness, no reactivity to pain, brain reflexes are absent even, and the patient is not breathing. And there is not only need for a ventilator, but also there is need for hemodynamic and even thermoregulatory support. What is this state? It's not sleep, of course. It's resembles more a brain death or deep coma than a physiological state. And then what happens after we terminate the administration of anesthetics? It's in a way the other way than seen in the induction. There's a gradual recovery from this brain state-like condition to coma, then to vegetative state, minimally conscious state. Then we see something which can be called primitive consciousness. As an anesthesiologist, I know what that can be, because sometimes patients recovering from anesthesia are not really behaving properly. It can be very primitive. And then after that, after full recovery, their normal brain function is restored. Then a few words about the mechanisms, what we know about different receptors. Of course, now we know that the effects of anesthetics, it's on the receptor level. And this slide summarizes the different transmitter and receptor systems. I don't go into details, but maybe I should just mention that maybe the two main mechanisms is really the GABAergic enhancement of the inhibitory GABAergic system. That's one possibility to induce unconsciousness or sedation. And the other option is to antagonize excitatory systems. Typically, glutaminergic NMDA receptors can be blocked, for example, by nitrous oxide and ketamine, and in that way, anesthesia or unconsciousness is induced. There are, as you can see, very different receptor systems, and maybe the two second most important ones is the potassium channels, especially the 2-pore potassium channels, and then muscarinic receptors. But I will not go into details, into the basic pharmacology or molecular pharmacology. And then one important thing, and it has an impact in designing these studies, is that the concentration or dose effect relationship of anesthetics is very steep. It's nearly a on-off phenomenon. So very, very small increase in dosage will induce a totally different behavioral state. It will induce unconsciousness. And that's, of course, a problem when designing these imaging studies, for example, in healthy volunteers. Then the right-hand side, you can see the correlation between loss of consciousness in humans and then the EC54 writing reflex in animals. Yesterday it was asked how consciousness can be studied in animals. Of course it can't be studied, but loss of writing reflex is a good surrogate for consciousness, at least based on this regression. What we know then on the...
Can you say what the right reflex
is? It's really animals, for example, rats are given anesthetics, and then when we look the concentration at which they lost their writing reflex, they, in a way, fall asleep. It's a very simple measure. Yeah. If they don't turn, you have lost the writing reflex. If they stand, then it's not. This slide illustrates what is known about the neural pathways of sleep and arousal, and this has really been important in understanding how the anesthetic works. And we have different systems. We have arousal systems. A is in the pons region, B is in the midbrain, C is in the hypothalamus and basal forebrain. And anesthetic can affect on these different neuronal pathways and nuclei and targets. And in the D, you can see sleep-promoting pathways, especially in the basal forebrain and hypothalamus. And in a way, as sleep is a balance between these two systems. It's a bistable system. It's a kind of flip-flop. Human body, for example, or animal trying to resist the change. And I think the same happens also with regard to effects of anesthetics. It's not similar to fall asleep and then to recover from sleep. There are two different systems which are important in this balance. And I think this is nicely illustrated in this kind of experiment, looking at the loss and return of consciousness or writing reflex in animals. Really the concentration at which the animal falls asleep or loses writing reflex is much higher than the concentration when the animal recovers from anesthesia. Even if you take into consideration the pharmacokinetic reasons, the equilibrium delay, it takes some time for the drug to get into the effect site. But even if you take this into consideration, it's really big difference, and this illustrates that. The loss and return of consciousness, they are not mirror phenomena. The next slide illustrates, this is rather hypothetical, where propofol exerts its effect. It's not that simple that it will be cortical, but in this illustration it's demonstrated or shown that especially the interneurons, GABAergic inhibitory interneurons in the cortex are important. And by enhancing here the GABAergic effect, you then decrease activity in the cortex and induce sedation or even unconsciousness. And there are different ascending arousal systems, dopaminergic, orexinergic, histaminergic, which are important in opposing this effect and trying to arouse the animal or human being. But really the question, what is the primary site? Is it in the deep structures or in the neocortex? It's not finally resolved. Then a few words about measuring the depth of anesthesia. And I, of course, start with EEG because most of the methods are based on EEG. And here you can see a simple summary of the EEG effects of anesthesia and normal sleep. Here we have the normal waking EEG with high beta activity. And then eyes closed, you see the typical alpha activity. And what happens then in normal sleep or in pathological brain conditions, you can see on the right hand side, and then on the left hand side you can see what happens in the anesthesia. Early in the induction period you can have a paradoxical excitation as demonstrated yesterday. There's even an increase in beta frequency, but the more anesthetic you give, the more deep you go in your anesthesia, then you increase the amplitude of the EEG signal and the frequency is decreased. So awake is really high frequency, low amplitude, and anesthesia is then high amplitude, low frequency. And if you still increase the dosage, you can end up in this kind of situation, so-called burst suppression, and even a flat EEG if you still increase the dose. What is the problem with the EEG is, of course, that it's very unspecific. Different drugs have different effects, but also anesthesia sleep and normal sleep, they can have very similar EEG, and even some pathological consciousness conditions like coma or vegetative state can really end up in having a similar kind of high amplitude, low frequency EEG, and that is of course a problem. Burst suppression is not seen in normal sleep, but can be seen also in pathological brain conditions. So the idea is to calculate from this EEG signal some kind of numerical value about of the hypnotic component of general anesthesia, that is unconsciousness. And there are several different devices and algorithms available. I don't go into details, but maybe the biggest and most well-known is so-called bispectral index, which was developed in the States in the early 90s. Then is another one which we have also used in our studies, so-called spectral entropy, but they are pretty much the same. But bispectral index has been studied in most of the studies. So this summarizes the basic idea. Awake, you have a small amplitude, high frequency, and in the deep anesthesia, it's the opposite. And now this is now extracted to a simple number, which can help us, the anesthesiologists, to administer the drugs. But really, the great problem of unintended awareness has not been solved, but I will come back to that later in my presentation. Then about the imaging studies. First of all, I would like to start with showing you the paradigm, for example, for using PET, positron emission tomography. And the idea here is that of course, we are interested in changes in neuronal activity. And to assess that, we are then using or determining the metabolic changes in the brain. For example, using fluorodeoxyglucose as a marker of glucose utilization or glucose consumption. That's one approach. But also, it is possible to use regional blood flow changes, for example, using oxygen 15 labeled water. It has some limitations, but it is possible to really assess neuronal changes with this method also. And I would like to show one classic paper by Michael Alkire, published in Anesthesiology. He did his first studies a couple of years earlier, but this summarizes very nicely what happens in a moderately deep anesthesia in a healthy volunteer. Awake, mild sedation, deep sedation, and unconsciousness, and he correlated these global changes or regional changes in glucose metabolism with this BIS EEG methods to measure depth of anesthesia. Roughly, one could say that this unconsciousness level of anesthesia, it induces a 50% reduction in metabolism. The next slide is an example of using regional blood flow, 15 oxygen-labeled water, as we have done in our studies, showing that brain areas known to be important in pain processing are increased or decreased after giving sub-anesthetic doses of nitrous oxide. Nitrous oxide is the laughing gas used in combination of general anesthesia or as an analgesic, for example, in labor. This study also was published some time ago, 20 years ago. Then I would like to show you some results of our own study carried out in Finland in collaboration with Antti Revonsuo. This was published, or actually presented, 4 years ago in ASA meeting, and then later, 2 years ago, published in Journal of Neuroscience. And the basic idea is shown here. First, we anesthetized healthy subjects by increasing gradually the dosage. And one problem with anesthetic drugs is that they are not pharmacokinetically very simple. They don't follow the so-called one-compartment model, but they show the two-compartment or three-compartment. So in order to induce or have very stable concentrations, you have to use computer-driven infusions, but that is nowadays possible. You have the pharmacokinetic parameters in the computer, and the computer estimates and tries to keep the concentration as stable as possible. We can call these steps pseudo steady state steps or concentrations. And the idea was here to gradually go to loss of consciousness or actually loss of responsiveness. And then the infusion was terminated. And the red arrows show that when the subject was responsive, and the blue arrows that he was unresponsive. They were healthy young males, mainly medical students from Turku, our participants.
What anesthetic did you use?
I will come back to that. We would use two different anesthetics, propofol and dexmedetomidine. Here is the second session then, after defining the individual concentration. As I explained earlier, the dose response is very steep, and also the individual doses can vary a lot. We did another anesthesia and, in the PET camera room. And in this case, we targeted to concentrations just below this loss of responsiveness, and then after loss of responsiveness, and did PET scanning at every step. And this is now showing the design for propofol. After terminating the infusion, we tested the responsiveness every minute. And then after they regained consciousness, followed the orders, we did an additional PET scan. But the other drug was a different kind of anesthetic. Actually, it's not used as an anesthetic. It's used as a sedative in intensive care unit. It's an alpha-2 agonist called dexmedetomidine. And what is interesting in dexmedetomidine, you can, with higher doses, induce unconsciousness, but you can recover the subjects by gentle physical stimulation and loud voices. And that enabled us to really regain the consciousness or responsiveness without changing the dosage. And that is really important, because most of the studies assessing unconsciousness or consciousness effects of anesthetics is really confounded by the fact that the concentration is different. But with this drug, it is possible to have exactly the same concentrations, but two different states. And actually, after this, we stopped stimulating the subjects, and they all fell asleep again. And then we did an additional fifth PET scanning, again with the same concentrations, but different behavioral state. So the design was slightly different because of the properties of the two drugs. And this now illustrates first what happens when you increase the dosage. We used a multivariate analysis, so-called partial least squares, which enables us to find different patterns of the effect. And what we saw is really a suppression of activity in the thalamus, in the cingulate cortex, and in the precuneus and the brainstem especially. This is now the drugs combined. We also analyzed the drugs separately, but the pattern was very similar with dexmedetomidine and propofol, in spite of the fact that the mechanism of action is so different. Actually, this is nothing new, because these kind of results have been reported with several drugs. This slide summarizes different imaging methods, different drugs, and really consistent findings, showing especially the reduction in the thalamus, which seems to be very common. Ketamine is an exception. It's not shown here, but all other drugs seem to induce a reduction, perhaps not only in the thalamus, but also in the default mode network, roughly. On the other hand, these are structures which are the highest activity at baseline. And this shows the cortical findings, and as you can see in pathological brain states, even sleep, and general anesthesia in other studies, the picture is quite the same. Reductions in the default mode network and the thalamus. But then our multivariate analysis enabled also to assess additionally what happened in the three conditions with dexmedetomidine. And this shows now the results of dexmedetomidine subjects and really taking all these three scans into the analysis. So different state, but the same concentration of the drug. And what you see is really activation related to this return of consciousness or responsiveness in the deep structures of the brain, the brainstem, the thalamus, and then the parts of the anterior cingulate cortex between the hemispheres, and only a small area in the parietal, inferior parietal area shown here. Not perhaps so surprising knowing the mechanism of action of alpha-2 agonists and dexmedetomidine. But what was really surprising to us that now in the partial least square analysis, a second important pattern was this very similar activation in the primitive brain structures, in the deep structures with propofol, which is thought more to affect on the cortical level. It's clearly different from dexmedetomidine. And when we combined these two drugs into one analysis, it was even more clear that it was really the thalamus, brainstem, and anterior cingulate cortex activation, which was related to this emergency from anesthesia. And then we termed this primitive consciousness immediately after recovery from general anesthesia, and that attracted some media interest also to our results. I don't know if it's the result is itself so interesting, but maybe this word primitive consciousness was something of interest. And really, to summarize these results, I think for dexmedetomidine, not a great surprise, but the results were so similar with propofol, that was a surprise to us. We also measured this bispectral index and entropy behavior in our subjects. And this is results from one of our subjects. Really, there's a reduction of these indices. This is now the bispectral index, and this is now the entropy. And you can clearly see that dexmedetomidine subjects, they are really responsive and reactive to this task. After each time you make the task, you see an activation in their brain. But in the other drugs, not so clear. We also had a third group in this EEG part, sevoflurane, which is a volatile agent, but we did not do the PET studies because volatile agents, they have direct vascular effects, and this PET imaging with radio water is not so good. And if you look at really all the values of all the subjects, you can see a reduction of these indices during the unconscious circumstances in it was statistically significant, but the variation between individuals is so large that these indices are not reliable in detecting unconsciousness. And if you calculate so-called prediction probability values, you end up in really lousy numbers. For example, here 0.52. 0.5 means like tossing a coin, so really no use in differentiating deep sedation and then unconsciousness.
What are you predicting there?
It's the so-called prediction probability. It's the performance of the method to differentiate consciousness, no conscious or from non-conscious. And if you calculate this deep sedation and compare that with loss of responsiveness, the values are very low, almost like tossing a coin. But if you compare the values observed in the unconsciousness state to the baseline awake state, then you can see that the prediction value is almost one. And quite often when these methods are described in the literature, they compare the wake values. But we were very critical and compared the deep sedation to really unconscious state. So not very good. And I think it's quite easy to understand if you look at our activation studies. No real cortical activation, but still the subjects were responding adequately. How can that be measured in the cortex? We also looked some connectivity changes. Of course, our sample size very low for this kind of network analysis, but we saw something interesting, and that was there was a association between consciousness and then a connectivity between this parietal cortical area and anterior gingivate cortex. And this is interesting because this parietal area has been shown to be important in motor intention. So to summarize our study, I think it's really in accordance with animal studies that this loss of consciousness and return of consciousness relation to general anesthesia, they are not mirror phenomena. Induction is different from emergence. There are two different systems, maybe even more complicated, but really there are two different biological systems. And really this primitive consciousness is, of course, what we found is important when you recover from general anesthesia. And of course, it must happen before the cortex can be aroused and activated. Then I will show an interesting result, another solution to take care of this confounder of different concentrations. And part of propofol effects can be inhibited or counteracted with physostigmine, which is a cholinesterase inhibitor. So by enhancing the cholinergic system, you can antagonize, you can wake up subjects. And they did that, and part of their subjects could be aroused in spite of keeping the propofol concentration constant. And they were able to demonstrate that in this group of responders, those who recovered or regained their consciousness, there was an activation again in the thalamus and in the precuneus, which was not seen in subjects who could not be aroused. One problem with PET not only is the resolution problem, but also the temporal resolution, not only the spatial resolution. And really, it's really, at best, it's minutes, not seconds. And if you do FDG scans, it can be even an hour to make the scan. So it's really not very good to look at subtle changes. fMRI is better, and I will now show some results of using a functional MRI. Of course, it can be used in different ways. It can be used in activation studies, but this study also shown yesterday shows the so-called resting state fluctuation, and this group was able to demonstrate that really within network connectivity was reduced when consciousness was lost, both in the default mode network and in the executive control network. And also the anticorrelation between the network seen at awake conditions was disappeared when the subjects were unconscious. On the other hand, the primary sensory areas like the visual and auditory cortices, they maintain their connectivity in spite of the unconsciousness induced by propofol. So this is a nice example that the brain receives and processes information, but it's not perceived normally under unconsciousness induced by anesthetics. This is an interesting study, recent study also using the fMRI bold fluctuation. There are actually two different pathways for sensory stimulation through the thalamus, so-called specific system, and then non-specific systems going to the centromedial thalamus. And the investigators were able to demonstrate that really this non-specific is important. This is now the connectivity at awake, and this is now showing that under unconsciousness induced by propofol, this connectivity is lost, and then again regained after regaining consciousness, after terminating the anesthesia. And I think this is a very interesting and important study. To summarize, I have tried to show that really anesthesia is an excellent tool to study human consciousness, and it could be used more to develop these new methods. And one advantage is, of course, is the possibility to standardize the conditions and do it in the laboratory conditions. I would also like to summarize by defining what is general anesthesia. It's a pharmacologically induced but reversibly and controllable coma. So it more resembles the situation in coma and brain death than physiological sleep, but has some resemblance to sleep, like the bistable system mechanisms behind inducing and then recovering from anesthesia being different. And I think in the next presentation we will hear more about this unique property of general anesthesia. And lastly, I would like to just mention that of course one serious limitation in this kind of studies is that we are really asking the subjects to do something, and that is then interpreted as a change in consciousness. But there are several reasons that the subject does not respond to our request. We didn't use muscle relaxants, but it's still possible that the subjects couldn't or didn't want to obey our commands, and that's of course one serious limitation. Now in our new study, which we have just started, we are trying to develop new EEG-based methods to really tackle this problem and find tools to separate the real conscious state. And it would be interesting then if we could do this separation, then to compare these imaging results within these groups to really find what is consciousness and what is responsiveness. But unfortunately, I don't have the results yet. And finally, I would like to thank my collaborators, my own group in Turku, University Hospital and University of Turku. We have been very much collaborating with Antti Revonsuo and his consciousness research group. Antti is both in Turku and in Skövde, Sweden. And then I would like to acknowledge the collaboration with our international groups, like the group by Michael Alkire. And especially I would like to acknowledge the great work of Michael, and he has actually been the motivation for us to start even these studies. And his first studies published in mid-90s, I think they were revolutionary, and he's a great gentleman and a great scientist. And finally, if you are interested in anesthesia mechanisms and anesthesia, I will show you some very good papers. This is a very good review already, though. Okay,
maybe
6 years old, but really the molecular mechanisms. This is now the more the system level approach. This is a very good review article, what anesthesia is, published in the New England Journal of Medicine a couple of years ago by Brown, Lilich, and Schiff. And finally, we have recently wrote a review article, how anesthesia can be used to tackle these problems. This is the University Hospital, and this is the PET Center in Turku. Thank you.